Good morning to all. I'm Dr. Padma Gunaratna, President, Sri Lanka Medical Association. We are at the beginning or to commence the webinar organized by the Expert Committee on Non-Communicable Diseases of the Sri Lanka Medical Association. I very warmly welcome you for this very useful webinar to all the clinicians, that is management of dyslipidemia at a time that the NCDs, particularly the cardiovascular diseases, are the leading cause of death. And almost it has a good proportion of people more than 35 years are hyperlipidemic and need treatment, therapeutic interventions for management of their dyslipidemia. At this point of time, I take this opportunity to communicate my sincere gratitude to Chair of the Expert Committee on Non-Communicable Diseases, Dr. Renuka Jayathissa, for her interest in organizing this webinar, and also her team. There are many senior registrars around her that who support her and create interest and promote education on non-communicable diseases among the medical profession. So I'm very thankful to all of them for their interest and for their this contribution to the SLMA in general. So we have three speakers lined up for this webinar. Our first speaker is Dr. Tushara Mathias. And let me invite Dr. Renuka Jayathissa, the consultant in medical nutrition, MRI, to introduce Dr. Tushara Mathias.
Thank you, Chair, President SLMA, Dr. Padma Gunaratna, for allowing us to do this seminar today. Let me introduce Dr. Tushara Mathias. I think Dr. Padma Gunaratna was mentioning it, everybody must have heard how colorful her career. She's a consultant physician attached to the Colombo South Teaching Hospital. At the same time, she's working as a senior lecturer to the Sri Javadanpura Medical Faculty. And she had many distinctions and things. I think everybody heard that what Dr. Gunaratna was mentioning, the things I think everybody know now. She's the best person to talk about it. Over to you, Tushara.
So the topic today is dyslipidemia in year 2021. And dyslipidemia is one of the most present metabolic abnormalities worldwide. And though it does not cause any immediate complications, we can modify this risk factor in order to reduce the cardiovascular morbidity and mortality. Hence the importance of the topic. So over the next 20 to 25 minutes, I plan on taking you through a lecture based on these four areas that I have identified, and I would like to focus your attention on the recent developments in these areas. So moving on to the first area, who and how to screen. When we talk about screening for dyslipidemia, there is this concept which is somewhat novel, but exactly not novel. So it has been lingering in the last few years, where most people now believe that we don't need a fasting lipid profile to screen for dyslipidemia for most adults. So when we compare the fasting lipid profile and the non-fasting lipid profile, there are only very minor changes between the components of a standard lipid profile. As for an example, the triglyceride is the one that would change mostly. It's roughly about 26 milligrams per deciliter, but the other components have very minor changes. And for all practical purposes, after many researchers and expert reviews, we can take it that for most adults in routine practice, a non-fasting lipid profile would be good enough as a fasting lipid profile. But having said that, there are certain individuals in which fasting becomes important. And that becomes important in patients who we believe that they might have a familial hypercholesterolemia, or if they have a family history of premature cardiovascular disease, such as a male less than 55 having a heart attack, or a female less than 60. And as I told you, that triglyceride is the one that mostly changes with fasting and non-fasting. If somebody has elevated levels of triglycerides, more than 400, and we have started them on treatment, then the fasting lipid profile becomes important. So you might wonder, why are we advocating an unfasting lipid profile? So if you can do fasting, by all means, that is recommended. But if it is not fasting, it does not make a big difference. That's what I want to mention. So we talk about the non-fasting lipid profiles because now when you think about the patient, when we ask them to do a lipid profile, most of the time patients keep deferring it. They keep deferring it because they have to go to the lab early in the morning to get the fasting lipid profile done. So this becomes cumbersome. For most patients who are working, this becomes cumbersome. So they might defer doing the lipid profile. So if you say non-fasting is equally okay, they might just walk in and get their lipid profile done. And when patients do blood tests, they frequently combine their tests together. So if somebody is screening for diabetes with HbA1c, they can at the same time do the lipid profile if fasting is not needed. So in this way, the patients are more compliant with their routine screening as well as their follow-up screening. And this avoids the delay in getting the test done. That is from the side of the patient. When we talk scientifically, there are many, many studies that have proven that fasting lipid profile and non-fasting lipid profile both predict the cardiovascular disease and the mortality disease risk equally. So in summary, for our practice, if someone wants to do a non-fasting lipid profile, that is equally advocated as the fasting lipid profile. So we all know about the standard lipid profile that we do. That is, we go and give the lipid profile and we get the total cholesterol, the LDL, the HDL, and the triglyceride and the VLDL. So apart from the standard lipid profile, there are a couple of tests that are being advocated in the recent most guidelines. And these are also quite useful, maybe not for all patients, but for certainly for a certain group of patients, these two tests that I'm going to mention are quite useful. The first test that I want to mention is the lipoprotein A, the lipoprotein small a. So lipoprotein small a is a molecule in which the ApoB is bound to a plasminogen-like molecule together with apolipoprotein A. So this test, if you do it once in a patient's lifetime, it generally remains constant throughout because it is highly heritable. And it does not vary with fasting, age, and other lifestyle factors. There are, of course, some minor changes, but generally it remains constant in a patient's life. So if you do for an individual once, repeat measurements are generally not recommended. This test is not available in the state sector freely, but in the private sector, it will roughly cost you about 6,000 to 7,000 rupees. We talk about lipoprotein A, so we need to know what is a cutoff. There are various cutoffs proposed, but generally the most of the international guidelines, as well as the expert view, is the lipoprotein small a is more than 50 milligrams per deciliter, that is high. In Sri Lanka, there are a couple of studies which have studied lipoprotein A in healthy volunteers, as well as in patients who have undergone CABG with cardiovascular disease risk, and they have roughly recommended the lipoprotein A cutoff between 17.3 to 50. So I think in keeping with the international guidelines, until our cutoffs are validated, we can take lipoprotein A being more than 50 milligrams per deciliter as high. So you might wonder, why do we have to do it? Well, though there is no treatment at present for lipoprotein A, there are certain studies being developed now which are studying the treatment, and certain treatments are in the pipeline. But as at the moment, if you do lipoprotein A in your practice and you find that the lipoprotein A is elevated, that is more than 50 milligrams per deciliter, you know that you need to put a special emphasis on controlling these patients' risk factors, especially the LDL. Because as at the moment, we have to control the LDL in order to control the lipoprotein A because there is no specific treatment for lipoprotein A. So in practice, I would say that we would do lipoprotein A if a patient has a family history of premature cardiovascular disease risk. And sometimes after assessing a patient's cardiovascular disease, the patient falls somewhere in between moderate and high risk. and we need to decide whether we need to give this patient a statin lifelong or not. In those situations also, this might be helpful. And the recent most guidelines, the European Society of Cardiology guidelines recommend that at least once in an adult patient's life, it is good to do the lipoprotein A because you have a rough idea about your cardiovascular disease risk. So since it's not too expensive, for those who patients who can afford in your practice, maybe you can do it so that you know how aggressively you need to manage the patient's cardiovascular disease risk. The next test that I want to talk about is apolipoprotein B. So apolipoprotein B is another molecule which correlates well with a standard lipid profile. So when we talk about apolipoprotein B, it generally correlates well with the LDL. But in certain individuals, such as diabetes mellitus, patients with diabetes mellitus, patients who are obese, patients who have high triglycerides, there might be a discrepancy. And that discrepancy stems from the fact that there are small and dense LDL particles which are not caught on the routine LDL value. So again, in a patient who you have a doubt, they fall in between moderate and high risk of cardiovascular disease, and you need to make a treatment decision, you can do apolipoprotein B in order to make your treatment decision. And it is specially recommended in patients with diabetes, patients who are obese, and patients who have high triglycerides. This test is also available in private sector as well as in some sector hospitals, and it will roughly cost you about 4,000 rupees. So having dealt with the test that we use for screening, now that we have a lipid profile in our hand and maybe with these two additional tests, we need to know how do we decide on treatment and how do you evaluate this patient's risk. So when we talk about the risk, say suppose you have a patient who is in front of you with the following results. The patient has a 45-year-old patient who has no previous illnesses, but who has a total cholesterol of 315, LDL of 228, and triglycerol 446. By the looks of it, you definitely think that the patient needs treatment. And then you have another patient, a 50-year-old patient with a total cholesterol of 300 and LDL not so high, but maybe around 150. So how do we decide on treatment? Most of the time, we look at the cutoff values in the lipid profile, but that is not the ideal way of going about it. Before we start a patient on treatment, there is a concept that we talk about, that is the cardiovascular disease risk. So what is cardiovascular disease risk? It is the likelihood of a person developing an atherosclerotic cardiovascular event over a defined period. So this is very important when we are making treatment decisions. It's not just based upon the LDL value or the total cholesterol of the patient. We have to assess the patient's cardiovascular disease risk. So in practice, when we calculate the cardiovascular disease risk, what you get is a number. We use certain scoring systems, and what we get is a number. Say, suppose the 10-year cardiovascular disease risk of a patient is either 7.5 or 20%, like that, you get a numerical value. So when you have a numerical value, it is very helpful in educating the patients. And the patients also have a target. They know that their risk is a certain level. So they know that they need to modify their behavior. And if you want to encourage them with their lifestyle measures, you can always use this number to educate them. And as I told you earlier, though dyslipidemia is a modifiable risk factor, it does not cause any symptoms and signs. So sometimes when you tell a patient, this is your cardiovascular disease risk, you need a treatment, they might wonder, why do I need drugs? I feel fine. I don't need a drug. I don't want to take it lifelong. So in those situations, for you to motivate the patient and to ensure that there is compliance, you can use the cardiovascular disease risk. An example would be if you tell a patient you have a 10% of having a heart attack in the next 10 years, you're telling them that 10 in 100 people like you will have a heart attack or a stroke in the next 10 years. So it's a way of putting forward the risk in an easier way so the patient understands. Having talked about cardiovascular disease risk, there are many validated risk scoring systems. And each of these risk scoring systems have merits as well as demerits. And they are not all validated in all populations. Now, SCOE is a system that the Europeans use. ACVD is what the Americans use. And the British use the QRIS3. In Sri Lanka, though we don't have a validated system, there are certain trials which are being done, and there are certain papers that have been published. And the Ministry of Health in Sri Lanka recommends that we use the WHO ISH risk scoring system. So that is what is recommended for the Sri Lankan population. So the first three scoring systems that I mentioned to you, the SCOE, the ASCVD, and the QRIS scoring system, they are all easily available. If you search for them on Google, you find that the risk calculators are easily available at your fingertips. So even at your practice, when the patient is next to you, you can input all the risk factors of the patient and you can get the score for that patient. So it's very easy to use in everyday practice. But when it comes to WHO ISH, though it is recommended for our population, we don't have the app at present. So we have to look at the chart. So it becomes a bit cumbersome when it comes to the patient. So this is what it looks like, the ASCVD. You input all the necessary factors and you get the scoring system for the patient. And the WHO risk categories, the charts look like this. So there are specific charts for diabetes, patients with diabetes, for smokers, non-smokers, and you input the total cholesterol value and you get the score for that patient. So the problem with the WHO ISH, it's a chart, so it's a bit cumbersome to use at the bedside of the patient or in your clinic practice. So having talked about the cardiovascular disease risk, there are certain patients that we don't have to calculate the cardiovascular disease risk. Now, if somebody has suffered a stroke already, if they have suffered MI already, then we don't have to calculate their risk because their risk is invariably high. You don't need a separate numerical value to tell the patient that they are at high risk. So in those patients, we don't calculate it. And also, if the patient or the family has been diagnosed to have familial hypercholesterolemia, that is a familial dyslipidemia, then again, you don't have to calculate. If the patient has chronic kidney disease, then again, we don't have to calculate. And there are certain other imaging findings as well as laboratory findings. If they are present, we don't calculate the patient's cardiovascular disease risk. So if there are carotid or femoral plaques on imaging, and nowadays patients undergo coronary CT, coronary angio. So if they know their coronary calcium score, then again, we don't need to calculate their cardiovascular disease risk. And I spoke about the LPA or the lipoprotein small a. So if they have high LPA values, again, you don't need this risk scoring systems. They are anyway at very high risk. So though we talk about this concept of risk, what we have to understand is all these risk scoring systems have their merits and demerits. As I showed you earlier, now in the earlier ASCVD, you see that only certain parameters are included, not all the parameters are included. So there are certain risk factors that a patient might have, which are not put into this scoring system. So that is not a complete scoring system. So because of that, the major guidelines recommend that if there are certain risk enhancing factors, then we have to consider the patient risk in a holistic approach, not just the score that you get after inputting all your values into the scoring system. So the certain risk enhancing factors that the major guidelines recommend are, as I told you earlier, familial dyslipidemias. That is one of the major risk factors. So if there is familial dyslipidemia, then we don't have to go by the score itself. This invariably the patient risk is going to be much higher. And if the patient has metabolic syndrome, and as we all know nowadays, non-alcoholic fatty liver disease is also part of the metabolic syndrome. So if they have non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, and if they have major psychiatric illnesses, chronic inflammatory conditions such as rheumatoid arthritis, we all know that autoimmune illnesses makes a patient more predisposed to having cardiovascular disease risk. So if they have these conditions, their risk is much beyond the score that you get from the scoring system. And another risk factor is preeclampsia. If a woman suffers preeclampsia during pregnancy, they are at high risk of developing cardiovascular disease risk later on in life. And also the next risk factor, as I put down here, South Asian ethnicity. So if you're South Asian in ethnicity, that is us, we anyway have a natural tendency of being more predisposed to having cardiovascular disease risk. So our risk is going to be much higher than what you get from these scoring systems. And also about the LPA I spoke about earlier. If your LPA is high, the risk is much more than the value that you get from the scoring system. So though we calculate risk, there are risk enhancing factors that we have to consider when we are making a treatment decision. So once we have the patient in front of us, we calculate their risk, and then we take into account these risk factors or risk enhancers that will tell us the patient is at high risk. And then we decide, we have to decide who we start on treatment with statins. So when we talk about statin therapy, there is primary prevention and there is secondary prevention. So primary prevention is when a patient who has not had a heart attack or a stroke, we are starting them on therapy. Whereas secondary prevention is they have already suffered an attack and we are going to give them statin therapy in order to prevent future disease. So who needs primary prevention with statins? So these are the criteria that are laid down. Say if you get a lipid profile of a patient and the LDL value standalone is more than 190, then they need statin therapy irrespective of their score, because very likely they have primary dyslipidemias most of the time. So if the LDL is very high, more than 190, generally they need therapy with statins. And the next risk factor is the cardiovascular disease risk I spoke to you about. So we can calculate the cardiovascular disease risk using various scoring systems. And if the scoring system tells us that this patient's risk is beyond a certain level, for WHO ISH is beyond 20%, for SCORE it's beyond 5%, for ASCVD it's beyond 20%. So it depends on the scoring system that you're using. If it is beyond a certain level, then we again start the patient on statin therapy. For type 1 diabetes, we generally give only if they have risk factors or if they have a longer duration of diabetes. If they have chronic kidney disease and non-dialysis dependent, then CKD stage 3 to 5, we again start the patient on statin therapy. Do we give statins for all patients with type 2 diabetes? Well, that is a bit of a difficult situation because there are several schools of thought when it comes to diabetes. So the American guidelines in 2018, they say to give for all diabetes type 2 more than 40 years, if their LDL is more than 70, to give them statin therapy. But the European guidelines, the NICE guidelines say to calculate their risk and only if their risk is high to give statin therapy. But what we practice in Sri Lanka most of the time is in keeping with the American guidelines. So if the patient is a type 2 diabetes mellitus patient above 40 years, and their LDL is more than 70, we generally give them moderate statin therapy. So when we talk about the risk and the benefit of starting statin therapy, we give primary prevention for those groups that I mentioned to you earlier. So apart from that, before you start on therapy, you need to always discuss with the patient before you start on therapy because they have to be on this treatment lifelong. And sometimes it is useful to consider their lifetime risk instead of the 10-year risk. And also, nowadays, many patients undergo CT coronary angio in the private sector. So if they have undergone a CT coronary angio, if the score is high, that is, if it is not zero, if it is between 1 to 99, they again benefit from statin therapy. If it is more than 100 or 100, they invariably need statin therapy. So these kind of adjuncts can be used to decide on your statin therapy if you are in doubt. So once you start the patient on primary prevention, what is the target that we are trying to achieve in LDL? We generally try to achieve the LDL target of these patients. So if the patient is at very high risk, then we try to bring it down to 55. If the patient is at high risk, we try to bring it to LDL 70. And if they are not in those two risk categories, but they just have familial dyslipidemias, we try to bring it to LDL 100. I spoke about primary prevention, and the next one is secondary prevention. So secondary prevention is they have suffered an MI or a stroke, or they have undergone some coronary revascularization, and we give them statins in order to prevent future attacks. So in this kind of situation, we give them statin therapy to bring the LDL down to 55 milligrams per deciliter. So it's not low. We bring it down to 55, and that is where the evidence is for. And say, suppose somebody has suffered one attack and they suffer another attack within the next 2 years, we bring it down even lower to 40. So there is enough evidence for these cutoffs. So this is the European classification of the risk categories I told, which I spoke about, the very high risk and the moderate and low risk. So this is readily available. You can have a look at it. Apart from the cardiovascular disease risk scoring system, there are certain risk factors we take into account. So when we talk about targets, we wonder, why do we have to reach these targets? So we say reach 55, reach 40. Why do we need to reach these targets? So there is enough evidence to say that reaching these targets is very helpful. So one of the major trials that was published, a meta-analysis by the cholesterol treatment trial is group in the Lancet in 2012, it showed that irrespective of the patient's primary risk category, if you reduce the LDL by 1 millimole, it will reduce the major vascular events by 21%. So this is something that you can tell the patient. Sometimes patient asks you, do I really have to bring my LDL this low? So there is enough evidence for it. If you reduce the LDL by 1 millimole, the major vascular events will reduce by about 21%. So that is something that is very significant. So we talk about targets. So we wonder whether we are reaching targets in Sri Lanka. In one of the studies that I did at Kalubovila, we found that only 17% reached the optimal targets. In the high-risk categories, only about 10% reached the target of 55. And two other studies, again published in Sri Lanka previously, done in Colombo and Gaul, showed roughly about 10 to 20% only reached LDL targets in Sri Lanka. So that is quite alarming, because if there is enough evidence for reaching these targets, we need to make an active role in reaching these targets in our patients. So the reasons for not achieving targets when we study about them, it's mainly because of clinical inertia. That means on the side of others, that is as practitioners, we don't do the lipid profiles regularly and follow them up. We think when we start them on statins, that's all. No, we need to check them again and then start them on statin therapy and monitor their therapy and optimize their therapy to reach these targets. And the other problem is poor resources and the testing limitations. We know that lipid profile is not available in all the major hospitals. In the major hospitals is available, but it's not available in all the state hospitals. So these testing limitations are also a factor that factors in to reaching these targets, because patients are unable to afford it in the private sector. So once we start a patient on statin therapy, we have to generally review them again in about 8 to 12 weeks and make sure that they reach their goals. And this is a part that we lack in. We don't check them again. We start them on statin and then we forget about it. So as I spoke about target, we wonder, if they are not at their targets, what can we do as practitioners? We have to always make sure that they are compliant with their medications. Sometimes patients don't take their treatment. If they have about 10, 12 drugs to take for a day, they might not take that treatment. So we have to check their compliance. And we can optimize our therapy. If we are on a moderate dose of statins, we can increase the dose of statins. Or we can move to a high efficacy statin. I will talk about the high efficacy statin in the next slide. And there is another treatment that we can use, that is acetamide. So we can combine the statin therapy with acetamide. And the last therapy, which is PCSK9 inhibitors, they're not available in Sri Lanka, but there's another therapy that is available for patients who do not reach LDL targets with statins alone. So when we talk about statins, there are several statin intensities. If we are giving a patient atorvastatin 40 to 80, that falls under high intensity. High intensity means the LDL will come down to about 50% from the baseline if you give them that statin. Moderate intensity means that is atorvastatin 10 to 20. So if you give them that, the LDL will come down by about 30 to 49%. So if your patient is not at target with your moderate intensity, you can go up to high intensity. So that is what we need to do for our patients. So when we talk about statins, as we know, the state sector statin that is available is atorvastatin, but in the private sector, all these other statins are available and you wonder whether there is any difference between them. So as long as the statin efficacy is maintained, there is not much of a difference, but there are subtle small differences between the drugs. Atorvastatin does not need any renal adjustment, whereas rosuvastatin needs renal adjustment. And generally, rosuvastatin has less drug interactions because it is not metabolized by the cytochrome system. So I spoke about this other drug. This drug is not available in the state sector at all times. There are stocks sometimes. It costs about 30 rupees a tablet in the private sector. So this is a drug that can be combined with statins if they are not at targets. What it does is ezetimibe reduces the absorption of cholesterol into our bodies. And on top of the reduction that you get from statin, we can reduce the LDL by about another 15%. So this is a therapy that we can combine in patients if they are not at targets with their statin therapy. There is another entity that we consider if the patients are not at targets, and that is statin resistance. So sometimes certain group of patients, because of genetic abnormalities, might not reach targets with statins. So patients sometimes ask you, doctor, my LDL is 30, 40, am I to be worried? Well, in the short term, there is enough evidence to say that because of the studies done on PCSK9 inhibitors, that LDL of about 30, 40 is not a risk. And recently there was a study, which was a follow-up study of the IMPROVE-IT trial, which studied the ezetimibe. Even after 6 years with very low LDL of around 30, 40, there were no major adverse effects. So it is okay, and it is not risky for the patients to reach low LDL targets. So as of the present evidence, we can say that there is no known adverse effects of very low LDL, that is somewhere around 40. So that's what you can tell your patients when they ask you whether my LDL is too low. So once you start the patients on statin therapy, we generally try to reach the LDL target. And after that, that is what I've been talking about. And after we reach the LDL target, we try to reach the non-HDL target. And that is where the triglycerides come into place. So many a times when the triglyceride is more than 200, our general first therapy is statin. It is not fibrates. But if the patient is at their LDL target in response to their risk factors, then we can consider adding a fibrate. So despite the triglyceride being more than 200, statin is still going to be your first therapy. And this is a recommendation in the recent guidelines. And after you give statin, if they are at LDL target and still the triglyceride is high, then you can add a fibrate. And in this group of patients whose triglyceride is high, you can add omega-3, that is icosapentaethyl, at 4 grams per day along with statins to reduce the triglyceride. This therapy, again, is not available in Sri Lanka. What you get over the counter as fish oil dietary supplements is not what the guidelines recommend. It's a pure form of omega-3, that is icosapentaethyl, at a very high dose, 4 grams per day. So that is not available in Sri Lanka. So this is for patients with hypertriglyceridemia. So patients ask you, is omega-3 helpful? Well, the fish oil dietary supplement that you get over the counter is not what the guidelines recommend for hypertriglyceridemia. The evidence is for pure form of EPA, that is a form of omega-3 that reduces triglyceride. So when the patient has been started on statin, we monitor two things. One is the liver function test and one is the creatinine kinase, because those are the two common abnormalities we get in patients who are started on statin therapy. So when the patients have baseline abnormalities, can you give statin? Well, you can. Many a time we see practitioners differing statin therapy because their baseline AST and ALT are high. But if the AST and ALT are not very high, if they are less than 3 times upper limit, we can definitely start them on statin therapy. And what the guidelines recommend is we have to monitor them. And if they're not doubling from the baseline, even if the AST and ALT are 150 or 200, if they're not doubling after you start your statin therapy, you can continue your statin therapy. You don't have to stop it. Because the main reason being, statin, what it causes is a transaminitis. An idiosyncratic liver reaction, liver injury that comes from statins is very rare. It's a transaminitis that we generally get. So this transaminitis, we won't be able to predict by doing routine liver function tests. So if the liver function tests are less than 3 times upper limit of normal, you can start statin therapy and then monitor the patient's liver function test to see whether they are doubling. And we generally do liver function tests once you start statin therapy, and then at 3 months, and then at 12 months, or else if you change the dose of statin. When it comes to creatinine kinase, because muscle symptoms are quite common in patients, if the baseline is more than 5 times upper limit, we generally don't start statin therapy. But if it is not more than 5 times upper limit, we can start statin therapy. And once you start statin, if the patient complains of muscle symptoms only, you go and check it again. Otherwise, you don't have to check it again. And even after you check it, if the creatinine kinase is not more than 10 times upper limit, you can actually monitor and continue statin therapy. But if it is more than 10 times upper limit, you stop statin therapy and you try to see whether you can re-challenge the patient with a smaller dose of statin gradually and see whether the patient can tolerate. So in practice, if the patient comes to you with muscle symptoms, what we do is we take time, we observe, we see whether there are any alternate cause for these muscle symptoms. If there are no alternative causes, we stop the statin for a short time if the CK is more than 10. Otherwise, we can observe by giving a lower dose of statin. And even after stopping statin and giving a lower dose, if the symptoms are not better, then we have to reevaluate to see whether there are any alternative causes. But if they are better after you stop your statin, you can generally slowly try to reintroduce your statin at a lower dose. You can try changing your statin. And as I told you earlier, you can add the ezetimibe, which is a therapy that is available in Sri Lanka, because that also reduces the LDL by about 15% in addition to the statin. So you can try doing these measures in order to tackle this patient who has muscle symptoms. So in summary, I would say when we start on statin therapy for a patient, you have to always discuss with the patient. It is a risk versus benefit when it comes to statin therapy. If they are at high risk, there is no argument about it. The patient has to be on statin therapy. But if they are moderate risk, if they fall between moderate and low risk, then you discuss with the patient, you take into account holistically all the risk factors of the patient. And then you communicate with the patient their cardiovascular disease risk. And based on that, you take a decision together with the patient. And this 10-year risk factor estimates that I told you about can sometimes underestimate the patient's risk. Therefore, you have to always take into account together with the patient's other risk factors. And the important thing about statins is most of the time when we give statins for primary prevention, the patient is not at any discomfort. They ask you frequently, doctor, I feel fine. Why do I need this lifelong? So that is the patient you need to engage and tell them the importance. Tell them that 21% of your major attacks are reduced by reducing your LDL by 1%. And you engage the patient and together with the patient, you go on this journey in modifying the LDL. And that's about it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Tushara. For that excellent presentation, I mean, I think you made it very clear for the audience that how you therapeutically manage the hyperlipidemia. I think we would leave questions at the end because of the interest of time. Let me invite our next speaker. Our next speaker is Professor Sudhira Kalupahana. The Professor Sudhira Kalupahana is a professor in human nutrition attached to the Faculty of Medicine, University of Peradeniya. He also is the adjunct professor in nutritional sciences at Texas Teaching University in US. Professor Kalupahana obtained MBBS and MPhil degrees from the University of Peradeniya and PhD degree in human nutrition from University of Tennessee, USA. He is a Scope National Fellow of the World Obesity Federation and a regular member of the American Society for Nutrition. Currently, Council Member of Sri Lanka Medical Nutrition Association and Sri Lanka College of Endocrinologists. So let me invite Professor Sudhira Kalupahana to make his presentation on dietary fats, the good, the bad, and the ugly. Dr. Kalupahana, over to you.
Thank you very much, madam. Can you hear me properly?
Yes.
Okay, so thank you very much for that kind introduction and as well as the invitation to give this lecture. And also I have to thank especially Dr. Tushara Mathias. She's the one who coordinated this since a long time back. And also, I'd like to thank Dr. Renpa Jayathis, our president of the Sri Lanka Medical Nutrition Association, who is the chair of the NCD Prevention Group at SLMA. So I think Dr. Tushara gave a very nice start to this topic, and she talked about the importance of the serum lipoproteins and their related relationship with hard disk. So I'm going to talk about the dietary aspect of this. So the title of this talk is Dietary Fats, the Good, the Bad, and the Ugly. So where did I get this title from? Now, for the younger members of this audience, this term good, bad, and the ugly comes from this 1960s Western movie. So here you can see there is the good guy, the bad guy. And so what does ugly mean? It does not mean that he looks ugly, but that means that you can't clearly say whether something is good or bad. So there can be a mixture of both. So I can say the same thing about, you know, dietary fats also. Some can be good, some can be bad, and some can be good or bad depending on the situation. So in the next 25 minutes or so, we will discuss these four major areas. First, we will try to understand the basic terminology, the ABCs of these dietary lipids. And then we'll talk about the dietary cholesterol and cardiovascular disease. And then we'll talk about the different fatty acids and their relationship to health. And finally, we will talk about some healthy eating patterns. Now, if you take dietary lipids, they can be classified into triglycerides, phospholipids, and sterols. So cholesterol belongs to a sterol group. So if you take triglycerides, mostly in most of the fats we consume, we find the fats in terms of in the form of triglycerides. So if you look at the chemical structure, they have a glycerol backbone, and attached to the glycerol, the glycerol backbone, you have the fatty acids. So the these triglycerides will be digested, and these fatty acids will be absorbed. So therefore, the biological activity will basically depend on the fatty acid profile of the triglycerides that we consume. So there are three ways to identify fatty acids. So first, we can look at the length of the carbon chain. So sometimes you can have shorter ones, you know, like 6 carbon, 8 carbon, and so on. Then we can have the medium chains, and then we can have the longer chains, 18, and so on. And then we can look at the number of double bonds. So that is a degree of saturation. And then we look at the this omega number. So these are the three things we consider when we try to identify a fatty acid. So here you can see on top, we have a saturated fatty acid. So if you look at the carbon skeleton, you can see there are no double bonds. So that's a saturated fatty acid. If you look at the second one, there is only one double bond. So that is, so one means mono. So it's a monounsaturated fatty acid. Then if you look at the bottom two, they have more than one double bond in the carbon skeleton. Now, depending on the position of the first double bond from the methyl end. Now there are two ends of this fatty acid. So this, the left one is called the methyl end, the right one is the carboxyl end. So if you count from the methyl end, so if you count here 1, 2, 3, the first double bond is at the carbon 3. So therefore it's called omega 3 fatty acid. Then if the first double bond is at the sixth carbon, so we can see from the omega end or the carbon, the methyl end, it's the sixth carbon, that's called the omega 6 fatty acids. Okay, so we have these four major types. Now, if you take, as I mentioned earlier, the polyunsaturated fatty acids, meaning they have more than one double bond, they are divided into omega 3 and omega 6 families. Now, it's very important to remember that not all omega 3s and omega 6 fatty acids are created equal. So, the major forms of these found. Now, if you take the omega-3, the major omega-3 in the diet will be the ALA, alpha-linolenic acid, which is mainly present in vegetables and vegetable oils and nuts and things. Now, if you take the major omega-6, that's the linoleic acid, or the LA, which is present again mainly in vegetable oils, vegetables, and so on. And then you have the longer chain omega-3s, the EPA and the DHA, which is mainly present in marine food, or the fish and seafood. And the longer chain omega-6 is arachidonic acid, which is mainly present in meat and animal products. There is another type of fat which is called trans fats. So the trans fats are generally produced during the commercial solidification of fat. So especially in olden days when they used to make margarine from the vegetable oils, they had this commercial hydrogenization. So that led to production of trans fatty acids. So now it's important to know, if you take a particular type of food, what is the predominant type of fatty acid in that particular food? So if you take MUFA, so the monounsaturated fats, they are mainly present in foods like olive oil, then nuts. And in terms of our Sri Lankan diet, we have avocado. So these foods have mostly monounsaturated fatty acids. Saturated fatty acids are present mainly in foods of animal origin, so meat, and then dairy products, full fat dairy products like cheese and full cream milk, and then also certain oils like coconut oil and palm oil. So they mainly have saturated fat. Trans fats, of course, mainly bakery items. Okay, so any bakery item will have, or the deep fried items will have the trans fats. Now, if you take the PUFA, the polyunsaturated fatty acids, now this is these are mainly present in the oils that we use to cook other than the coconut and the palm oils. So here you can see mainly the ALA, LA, both omega-6 and omega-3 are there in these oils. Now, if you talk about omega-3s, we generally refer to the omega-3s, EPA, DHA, which are present in the seafood. Now, omega-6 arachidonic acid, we don't talk about this so much, but then this is really associated with heart disease and cancer and so on. This is mainly present in meat and foods of animal origin. Right, so now that we have a basic understanding of the classification of dietary lipids, then we can go on and discuss about dietary cholesterol and cardiovascular disease. Now, if you take cholesterol, the chemical, the compound, it is an essential component of our cell membranes. It's produced by the liver in our body. Now, it's very important to remember that cholesterol is only found in foods of animal origin. So I'm sure if you go and look at a vegetable oil or coconut oil bottle, you will see this is cholesterol free. They will proudly display that as cholesterol free. Now, not a surprise, because none of the vegetable products will have cholesterol. Then, of course, biologically, cholesterol has certain important functions. We know that. So now, now Dr. Tushara Mathias clearly showed us the relationship between high LDL levels and cardiovascular disease, and also the current statin therapy. As a target, you use the LDL levels. So absolutely, there is no doubt in the evidence. It's very clear. Now, this early study called the 7-country study showed this relationship between a serum total cholesterol and the coronary heart disease mortality. So you can see clearly a very nice linear relationship. So now the problem is, so now we know the cholesterol, blood cholesterol, high blood cholesterol are associated with heart disease. Now there is dietary cholesterol. So we need to clearly identify the difference between the cholesterol in our food and the blood cholesterol. Now, one of the foods which has the highest level of cholesterol is the egg. So therefore, this question came up as to, can dietary cholesterol increase the serum cholesterol? So at that time, you can see Time magazine published this photo showing two eggs and a bacon in a sad face, okay? But then subsequently, when you look at like almost all the studies, you know, so this is from the health professionals follow-up study and the nurses health study. Now, remember, in nutrition, it's very difficult to do randomized control trials like large ones. So we basically depend on this prospective cohort studies as our level A evidence. So if you look at this, you can see egg consumption is not associated with heart disease risk. This is in men and this is in women, so absolutely no relationship. Then another later study, meta-analysis, again you can see egg consumption and cardiovascular disease, absolutely no relationship. Another study, the BMJ, no relationship. Same study, meta-analysis, no relationship between egg consumption and cardiovascular disease. So therefore, a couple of years back, the American Heart Association, they put out this statement saying that the dietary cholesterol is not a nutrient of concern for overconsumption, meaning you don't have to limit the dietary cholesterol. So therefore, the Time magazine now published this smiley face. Now, they were smart. They did not put the bacon here. Instead of that, they put an avocado here. Okay, so meaning that bacon is still bad. So what about eggs? So the eggs are a very high quality source of protein. Like a medium-sized egg would have about 7 grams of protein per egg, has a lot of vital vitamins and minerals, has carotenoids, choline, and it improves satiety. So if you eat an egg for your breakfast, that'll sort of keep you away from hunger for a while. It's very affordable. That is the most affordable animal protein in the market and very convenient. You know, even a person like me can make an egg in the morning for breakfast. Right. So now I think we got the egg question out of the way. So now the second question is, can other dietary fats affect serum cholesterol? So now we will talk about the different fatty acids and health. So here we have what is called this diet heart hypothesis. So what this hypothesis said was that if you have certain types of fat, that can increase the blood cholesterol. And we know that if you have increased blood cholesterol, that will lead to coronary heart disease. So therefore, subsequent evidence showed that if you reduce the saturated fat intake and increase the polyunsaturated fat, it will sort of favorably affect the LDL and HDL fractions, leading to a reduction in coronary heart disease. So is there evidence for this? So here you can see from this meta-analysis published in Circulation in 2017, if you replace the saturated fat, the bad guy, with the polyunsaturated fat, the good guy here, you can see there's a significant reduction in cardiovascular disease risks. You can see about 29% reduction in risk, fairly significant. Then what about trans fats? Trans fats, again, there's very clear evidence. It raises the LDL, lowers HDL, and also increases the risk for heart disease. So you can see all these products, bakery products, you know, they contain trans fats. Now, in nutrition research, when you try to reduce a particular type of fat, you have to replace it with something because fats contain calories. So if you reduce calories from one source, you have to increase calories from another source. So you have to either replace a type of, let's say, the saturated fat with another type of fat, or you have to replace the saturated fat with carbohydrates. Now, what happens if you replace the saturated fat with trans fats? Now, this happened earlier when people replaced butter with solid margarine. So solid margarine had increased trans fats, and what happened? It actually increased the heart disease risk, okay? But if you replace the saturated fat with MUFA, monounsaturated fats, like in olive oil and so on, it reduced the cardiovascular disease risk. If you replace the saturated fat with polyunsaturated, again, it reduced the cardiovascular disease risk. But if you replace the saturated fat with refined starches or sugars, meaning you reduce the consumption of coconut, but you increase more white rice instead, what happens? Absolutely no change. In fact, there's a trend to increase the risk. But if you replace it from whole grains, you know, there is a bit of a reduction in cardiovascular disease risk. So it's important what you replace a saturated fatty acid with. Now, remember, when we are talking about these dietary compounds, we are not only worried about cardiovascular disease, we are worried about total mortality, then the mortality from other causes like cancer, the neurodegenerative diseases, respiratory diseases, and so on. And you can see the same pattern can be seen in all these categories if you replace saturated fats with polyunsaturated or monounsaturated fats, all have benefits. Whereas if you replace saturated fats with trans fats, all these things increase. So the message is very clear. So therefore, the American Heart Association in 2017 put out this advisory saying that replacing saturated fat with healthier fat, that is the monounsaturated and polyunsaturated fats, could lower cardiovascular risks. So if you look at the fatty acid profile of some of the common oils and fats in our diet. Now, if you look at this particular graph, this sort of pink color shows saturated fat. This yellow color shows the omega-6 linoleic acid. And then this light blue color shows the omega-3 ALA. And the purple color shows the monounsaturated fats. So when you are trying to select a vegetable oil or an oil, the cooking oil, we should try to go for a high MUFA or a high PUFA kind of oil. So you can see if you take something like olive oil, it has a very high monounsaturated fats, about 77%. Okay, canola oil has a fairly similar composition, 62%. And then now in terms of our context, this gingerly oil or the sesame seed oil, the talathel also has a similar composition. Now avocado also has a similar composition. Now I've been telling people, my friends in the food industry, try to start to have avocado oil in Sri Lanka. That will be like olive oil, but nobody's taking up the idea. Then if you take things like sunflower oil, and soybean oil, you can see they are more PUFA rich, okay, and low saturated fats. But if you take things like coconut oil, palm oil, and then other animal fats like lard, beef fat, and butter fat, they are very high in saturated fats. So now I think you know about the evidence, and now you know how to select a good oil. Now, there has been a lot of recent controversy about coconut oil, especially a lot of marketing, so that there have been touted some benefits of coconut oil. But when you look at the literature, so in fact, there is this American Heart Association, they had this special paper in 2020. So they did a systematic review and meta-analysis and clearly showed that coconut oil increases LDL cholesterol. So very clear. And from our own backyard, our very own Professor Anil Jayawardena and his colleagues, they did a similar review and found that coconut oil actually increases the LDL cholesterol. So very clear evidence. Right. So now moving on from the saturated fat and PUFA into omega-3 and omega-6. Now, if you take omega-3 fatty acids, now if you look at this earlier study, they found that, so in this particular study, they compared two different populations, Eskimos versus Danes, people from Denmark. Now, Eskimos, as we know, they consume basically fish. So if you look at the fat content, fat intake fairly high, but if you look at the omega-3, Eskimos, you know, they contain a large amount of omega-3. So 13.7 grams per day is a fairly big amount. Danes, in comparison, consume about 2.8 grams. Now, the interesting thing is, if you look at their triglyceride levels, you can see compared to Danes, the triglyceride level of the Eskimos is even less than half of the Danes. So this initial study pointed that maybe there is a benefit of eating fish in lowering the triglycerides. So subsequently, other studies have clearly shown that fish intake is associated with a reduced risk of cardiovascular disease. So very clear evidence. So then people started to sort of look at the bioactive compound omega-3s and then extracted them into fish oil capsules. And then they wanted to see, if you take fish oil capsules, will you see the same benefit? Unfortunately, you did not see that benefit. So fish oil supplements did not decrease the cardiovascular disease risk. But then when they looked at the data carefully, they found that in individuals who have a high triglyceride level, as well as a high LDL cholesterol levels, these fish oil supplements will actually reduce the cardiovascular disease risk. And then this led to this recent randomized control trial. I think Dr. Tushara Mathias mentioned about the findings from this study. So they actually gave this very purified form of omega-3, icosapent ethyl, a fairly high large dose, 4 grams. Okay, so it's a fairly large dose. And you can see in individuals with higher cardiovascular disease risk, they significantly reduced the primary output for the outcome was the cardiovascular disease, cardiovascular events. Okay, so if you have high cardiovascular disease risk, if you give high doses of omega-3s, that can reduce the cardiovascular events. So what is the guideline from the American Heart Association? Omega-3 fatty acids, either EPA, DHA or the EPAO at a high dose of 4 grams per day are an effective and safe option for reducing triglycerides as monotherapy or adjunct to other lipid lowering agents, which I think Dr. Mathias mentioned. Now the problem is in Sri Lanka, we don't have this preparation and the fish oils we have only have about 500 milligrams. So if you want to achieve this dose, you might need to take about 8 fish oil capsules per day. So what about for everybody? For cardiovascular disease health, it is recommended that a minimum intake of EPA, DHA combined, we should take at least 500 milligrams per day. How do we take this amount? You know, if you eat fish or seafood twice per week, you will get this amount. You don't have to worry about that. So you don't have to take supplements. If you eat fish 2 or more days a week, and for vegetarians, again, there's no problem. You don't have to take this because the body will synthesize the adequate amount. Since they are not eating meat, it's not going to be an issue. Now, recently we have shown some very interesting other aspects of omega-3s in this review paper we published last year. We showed that they can have some effect on this phenomenon called browning, so maybe has potential for anti-obesity therapy in the future. And then we know there's a lot of interest about gut microbiota, so omega-3 fatty acids can modulate the gut microbiota also, right? So having considered all these things, what does the World Health Organization say about dietary fats? So they say that unsaturated fats are preferable to saturated fats and trans fats of all kinds. So which is very consistent with the evidence and the American Heart Association guideline. So what do they define as unsaturated fat? The oils coming from fish, avocado, nuts, sunflower, soybean, canola, and olive oils. Then they consider saturated fat, fatty meat, butter, palm and coconut oil, cream, cheese, ghee and lard. So unfortunately our country is trying to replace coconut oil with palm oil. So you can see where we are heading, right? So trans fats present in industrially produced baked and fried foods, cookies, biscuits, cooking oils and spreads, especially these solid spreads. And also they can be present in these things like meat and dairy, and the WHO actually says, in fact, the natural source of trans fats are also pretty bad. So now coming back to our this diet heart hypothesis. So originally we said that if you reduce saturated fat and increase polyunsaturated fat, it will favorably affect the lipid profile and reduce coronary heart disease. But then now we know that actually LDL is actually only a marker for cardiovascular disease risk. There are a lot of other factors that are important. In fact, some people with normal LDL do get heart attacks, right? So therefore, so LDL cholesterol is a single lipid marker. And as Dr. Mathias said, there are a lot of other new markers also. And then there are other factors, non-lipid factors like blood pressure, thrombosis, then endothelial function, inflammation is a big thing. Then the glucose, insulin, microbiome I mentioned, right? So it's fairly complex. So all this will lead into the complex interaction will lead to coronary heart disease. So therefore, now instead of focusing on individual dietary compounds, we actually focus on foods and dietary patterns. So therefore, this concept of healthy eating is extremely important. So what are some of the healthy eating patterns which can reduce the cardiovascular disease risk? Now, this is one of the landmark studies in this area. So this the PREDIMED trial. So they looked at, so it's a randomized control trial. So they looked at the primary prevention of cardiovascular disease with a Mediterranean diet supplemented with extra virgin olive oil or nuts. So this was a multi-center randomized controlled trial in Spain. So big conflict of interest here because Spain is the largest producer of olive oil. So large sample, about 7,000 odd patients with high cardiovascular risk, but no CVD at enrollment. So they had three groups. First group, they gave a Mediterranean diet supplemented with extra virgin olive oil. Second group, a Mediterranean diet supplemented with nuts. Third group was a controlled diet, which is the advice to reduce dietary fat. The major primary endpoint was major cardiovascular event. So what did they find? They can, you can see in these the graphs, you can see clearly compared to the controlled diet, both the Mediterranean diet with extra virgin olive oil as well as nuts clearly reduce the cardiovascular events, okay? And if you look at the total mortality, especially the Mediterranean diet with extra virgin olive oil reduce the cardiovascular, the total mortality. So very really benefits of Mediterranean diet. So what is this so-called Mediterranean diet? So here, you know, they base their diet on a lot of fruits, vegetables, whole grains. Then they do consume a lot of olive oil. Then beans, nuts, legumes, seeds, herbs, and spices. Now, we can easily practice this type of diet in Sri Lanka. The only issue we have is the olive oil. But you can see we do have a lot of fruits and vegetables. We can consume whole grains like whole grain rice and so on. We do consume a lot of legumes like dal, cowpea, kadala, green gram, and so on. And we use a lot of spices. Then at the next level, they consume a lot of fish and seafood. To a lower level, poultry, eggs, cheese, and yogurt. And the least amount, they consume meats and sweets. So what type of healthy eating can be applied to the Sri Lankan context? Now, for the Sri Lankan context, we have proposed these two plates. So the one on the left is the healthy plate for everybody. You can see half the plate as you know, grains or starchy vegetables. The other half we divide into three, two-thirds should be vegetables and one-third should be a protein. Now for people with diabetes or who want to lose weight, you go for this other plate where half would be vegetables, quarter should be the grains and quarter protein. Now we talked about dietary fats and oils. So it's very important to talk about food cooking techniques also, because we don't recommend deep frying as a cooking method. Instead, you can use food prepared with spices, and then you can use this whatever healthy oil you are using for stir frying. And then you can, vegetables, you can do things like steaming, you know, having as a soup and so on. So ladies and gentlemen, in summary, dietary cholesterol is not a nutrient of concern. Saturated fats, trans fats, and refined carbohydrates adversely affect blood cholesterol. Healthy eating patterns, example, Mediterranean eating pattern, are more important than individual nutrients. Fruits, vegetables, whole grains, legumes, fish, nuts, and healthy plant oils constitute a healthy eating pattern. So thank you very much. And if you have any further questions about healthy eating, you can visit my professional Facebook page. I have some videos there. And also we have our Sri Lanka Medical Nutrition Association webpage. It's a great resource for healthy eating and any questions about dietary practices. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Sudhira, for that excellent presentation on dietary fats, the good, the bad, and the ugly. I think that is the time now for us to answer questions. I think that there would be more questions for you that if you wait a while, I will start with the, Tushara Mathias. Tushara, because there are a lot of questions that they have put while you were talking.
Madam, I answered some of them in the chat box already, but
thank
I can
you so them. Much. Thank you so much. The for a FBS 8, 10 hours fasting is needed. But if we are checking FBS plus fasting lipid profile, 12 hours. Please be kind enough to explain about both FBS and lipid profile together. Affects FBS value.
No, madam, there is no such relationship. The only thing where we talk about non-fasting lipid profile is because it is convenient for the patient. But by, of course, all means, the patient wants to do a fasting blood sugar and they are fasting for 10 hours, the patient can give the blood for the lipid profile at the same go.
Thank you very much. Can we do non-fasting lipid profile in pediatric population?
Madam, that's a bit of a tricky question because usually in kids, we don't check our lipid profiles routinely. We would do it only if there are certain indications. And I can think of two such indications. One would be if we are suspecting familial hypercholesterolemia and we are cascade screening. Once we identify the index patient with familial hypercholesterolemia and if we are cascade screening the family members, that might be one situation. So in those situations, especially in familial hypercholesterolemia, fasting lipid profile is what is recommended. So in that situation, I think fasting is recommended.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Are there separate cutoff values for lipid panel in different conditions, example, CKD, diabetes, and so on?
Madam, there are no specific cutoffs, but the patient's cutoff of the LDL comes from the cardiovascular disease risk of the patient. And that generally we take it from the ESC guidelines because what the American guidelines suggest is a reduction from the baseline as a percentage reduction. They are not talking about LDL target, a numerical value. So, but the ESC guidelines, they will tell you the specific cutoff we need to reach for each risk category. So it's not based upon the comorbidity, but it is based upon the risk of the patient.
Thank you, Tushara. What are the criteria to stop the statin therapy?
Once we start for high-risk patients for secondary prevention, we generally don't stop statin unless there are adverse effects. But if we do start for primary prevention, then we are supposed to periodically assess the patient, and especially as the patient ages, because as the patients are aging, there is polypharmacy and their patients are more prone for side effects. So in those situations, especially when the patient reaches about 75 years, you have to be careful with the drugs we are giving. But otherwise, there is no strict regulation as to when to stop statin for primary prevention. Periodically, we can assess the patient, and depends on the quality of the life of the patient, we can decide on continuing life now.
So there are many questions on how to tailor off statins. I mean,
the
answer
is
there.
No,
you do not tailor off. Yes, yes. Yeah. Is it possible to send the recorded person? Oh, I'm sorry. I think, yes. Many are asking for recorded. Right. I think these are coming now to Sudhira. Would like to know the state of gingerly oil.
Yes, as I mentioned earlier, gingerly oil has again high monounsaturated fatty acids. So we can consider it as a healthy oil, provided that you use it, as I mentioned, don't use it for deep frying. You can use it for stir frying, moderate amount.
How many eggs can we safely consume per day? Is there any difference
actually,
egg white and yolk?
There is no restriction for the amount of eggs per se, but so we can safely say one egg per day is absolutely fine. But there was a recent clarification by the American Heart Association in 2020 saying that again that it's the overall healthy eating pattern that is important. So for them, of course, they have recommended up to 2 eggs per day. So we don't have evidence to say not to eat more than 1 egg per day. But, having said all that, I can say safely say you can have 1 egg per day without any problem. It's a good source of protein.
All right. And then what is better to consume in same quantities, PUFA or MFA rich oils?
Yeah, so if you look at the type of oil, I would say MUFA, the monounsaturated, have the more, they are kind of more neutral kind of fatty acids. So I would say go for something with a high MUFA. So that's why we go for olive oil, canola oil, or gingerly oil, avocado oil, and so on.
Does deep frying with olive oil reduce its benefit?
We do not recommend deep frying with any oil. As a cooking technique, we don't recommend deep frying. So anyway, things like extra virgin olive oil, you should never use them for deep frying, but they can be used for stir frying. So absolutely no problem. The problem with deep frying is, you can generate a lot of other so the fat content is higher, and also people tend to reuse the same oil for deep frying. So what we advise is avoid deep frying and use other healthy cooking techniques?
I think it's the same answer as there. Can we use olive oil for frying? And does it make any biochemical changes in the structure of the olive oil while frying? You answered that, no?
Yeah, you can use it for stir frying, yes.
What about using olive oil or sunflower oil in baking products?
Yeah, it's fine. It's fine.
Since we do a lot of deep frying,
So I think since this question of deep frying repeatedly comes up, now it's I would say it's something similar to smoking or alcohol. Now, yes. Now we have said that alcohol is bad and so on. So then you can't keep on asking, should we drink wine or arak or beer? So it's a lifestyle thing. So, you know, it's bad. So I think we should try to get away from that and go for healthy cooking practices rather than trying to justify which oil is good for deep frying. So I think as a practice, we have to get away from deep frying if you want to reduce the cardiovascular disease risk and so on.
No, I don't know. Since we don't do a lot of deep frying, coconut oil better than unsaturated ones concerning risk of CIS to transconversion?
So again, I showed you the evidence clearly. So evidence clearly shows that coconut oil increases the LDL cholesterol. So my advice is, you know, avoid coconut oil and go for something other than that. But now here, the problem is now when you go like a give like a public kind of message, I think the first message should be about the cooking technique. So we should try to minimize the oil we are using. So especially try to avoid the deep frying. And then, you know, we have to look at the prices and all that too. So then if possible, I would definitely say go for a healthy oil, something like sunflower. If you can't obviously afford olive oil, go for something like sunflower oil.
I think these are mothers, I think with children, with athletes. Is it okay to eat 45 eggs per day, especially for athletes and bodybuilders?
I would not recommend eating more than 2 whole eggs per day for anybody. You can eat unlimited amounts of egg whites. So a whole egg has about 7 grams of protein. Egg white has about 2 to 3 grams. So if you want to meet that protein requirement, you can have any amount of egg whites as you want. But I would not recommend taking more than 2 whole eggs.
Any suggestions on using omega-3 supplements that are available in Sri Lanka to treat high triglycerides?
So again, as I said, I think Dr. Tushara will also agree. I mean, you can't reach that level of 3 to 4 grams with the supplements we have unless we consume about 8 capsules per day. And also you have to sort of consider about the purity of these, because unless they are really pure, they can have mercury contamination. So that is also another thing. So I am not a big fan of going for these supplements to meet that kind of a dose.
Could you please explain on dry cough as in hyperlipidemic treatments? Is there anything like that? Could you please explain on dry cough as in hyperlipidemic treatments? I do not know. We'll pass that.
I can't think of a reason, madam. We don't find that in patients.
Yes.
We can't think of a reason.
Yes. Right. Other questions, I think. Is there any specific vegetables for hyperlipidemia? Specific vegetables.
Yeah, so again, I think I'll answer that question. I think in Sri Lanka, we have this fondness of classifying food as good and bad foods for particular illnesses. So again, people ask about what are the good foods for COVID and all that. So there are no good foods or good vegetables or everything. So there is only what is called healthy eating. So I explained that. So try to follow the healthy eating. So that's why we see sometimes in people with diabetes, they try to eat a particular food like too much quantities. So again, don't think of it like that. There are no good foods or bad foods as such. So it's the eating pattern that matters.
What about the fat content of prawns and cuttlefish?
Yeah, again, good question, because I have seen even cardiologists, you know, sometimes recommend that you cut down these things. But again, that's a myth, like something we used to say, because these things tend to have a little bit higher dietary cholesterol. But if you take omega-3s, these seafood like cuttlefish, prawns, they have a fairly significant amount of omega-3. So provided you prepare them in a healthy way, like stir frying and, you know, cooked with spices, they're absolutely fine to take. Yeah, they are good source of protein and omega-3s. Yes.
Can you please give some advice on giving egg, butter, yogurt, and full cream milk for children, especially less than 5 years?
So again, in children less than 5 years, we encourage healthy eating. So again, don't try to give too much of one thing. So you can use the healthy oils, you know, for cooking, as I mentioned. So give the, you know, the food groups. So you have to give them adequate proteins, you have to give them grains, you have to give them fruits and vegetables. So sort of, because that is the habit that they are going to continue throughout their life. So teach them healthy eating practices. But other than that, don't try to give it too much of one thing, too much of butter or too much of eggs or everything. Give everything in moderation. But if the child is having overweight or obesity, you might have to cut down these fats based on the advice of your doctor.
Any relation on taking garlic in honey for hypercholesterolemia?
If you have hypercholesterolemia, I think Dr. Tushara Mehta has made it absolutely clear you have to take a statin, period. So people come to me also and they are taking statins and they also take loading them up with garlic and things. So again, I have to say that there is no dietary food or there's no food item which can lower cholesterol. If your cholesterol is high, please listen to your doctor, physician and take the statin. And garlic and things, when taken in excess, can lead to things like gastric irritation. So please don't do things like that.
What are your thoughts on keto diet?
Yeah, so keto diet, I think there was a question about the intermittent fasting also. So now all these are what are called weight loss diets. Now remember, we're talking about dyslipidemias and healthy eating. Now, weight loss is a different thing. So if you are overweight or obese, it is recommended that you lose about 10% weight. So for weight loss, there are different types of eating patterns. So keto diet is one such thing. If you do it in a healthy way, it is fine. Same with the intermittent fasting. But I have seen that nowadays, people are trying to practice this intermittent fasting as a day-to-day eating practice, which is absolutely, you know, you should not do that. Because this is only for weight loss for a short period. You should not try to do this in the long run.
All right. But can high carbohydrate diet increase lipids? This is the last question, Sudhira.
I think Rishara can also clarify on this. And in my experience also, when people tend to eat too much rice, you know, their triglycerides will go up. What do you think, Rishara?
Yeah, it's one of the reasons people think that they're not eating fat, but their intake of starch is high. So as you said, I think healthy eating, everything in moderation should be the key message.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much to Dr. Tushara Mathias and Professor Sudhira Kalupahana for this excellent presentation on management of dyslipidemia. I'm sure that you did contribute so much for the medical profession by communicating these messages and educating doctors more than the public so that would be spread to people, the community, and that would be a great service for our nation. So thank you again. And I'm thankful to the expert committee on non-communicable diseases of Sri Lanka Medical Association for organizing this excellent and most useful webinar on management of dyslipidemia, and also thankful to all who joined online to this webinar. That was so much informative. So thank you very much and have a nice day. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.